We are going on an adventure.
Join me as I take you to some of the world's most incredible and romantic ruins. We'll talk about the history, the people, the stories. I'm Evelyn Edwards, and this is Queen of the Castles.
Hi friends, we are at Farleigh Hungerford Castle in Farleigh Hungerford, which is about 8.5 miles from the World Heritage City of Bath, which is where I live, in the southwest of England. You might have noticed that we haven't been able to make a video in over 3 months. We're so excited to be able to get back out there and explore and show you amazing places again. So Farleigh Hungerford Castle is actually my local closest castle, and it definitely doesn't disappoint. In this episode, I'm going to tell you all about the Hungerford family, which lived in this castle for 300 years. There's just some mind-boggling stories with the Hungerford family. There's murder, there's mayhem, there's some serious marital strife. The Hungerford family was very closely linked to both Lancastrian and Tudor monarchs. They fought in some of the most famous battles in the War of the Roses and the Hundred Years' War. And they really got themselves into a lot of trouble. So I'm going to show you around this fantastic place. The more I learn about the family, the more I'm fascinated by where they lived. So I'm going to show you around, and I'm going to tell you some stories. So let's go in. The name Farleigh evolved from the Anglo-Saxon word fern lega, which means the ferny pasture, which is a perfect description for this beautiful, green, lush area even to this day. The manor house of fern lega, or Farleigh, or Farleigh Manor, is mentioned in the Domesday Book. And if you wanna know a little bit more about the Domesday Book, I talk about it in this episode up here. I'll link that for you. So it's mentioned in the Domesday Book, and William the Conqueror granted it to Roger de Courcelle. Then it passed from family to family until in 1369, Sir Thomas Hungerford purchased it for £733. Sir Thomas Hungerford came from a prominent Wiltshire family, and he made his fortune being the chief steward for John of Gaunt. And John of Gaunt is important to the Hungerford family and our story and the story of England, because through John of Gaunt came the royal house of Lancaster, and his son became King Henry IV, who was the first English ruler who spoke English after the was a native English speaker after the Norman invasion. Thomas Hungerford looked over all of John of Gaunt's Welsh and Southern properties. He became the first speaker of the House of Commons, and he was knighted, and that is how Farleigh Hungerford became Farleigh Hungerford Castle.
We'll be right back.
Thomas began the work of constructing his new castle probably around 1375 to 1383, using parts of the existing manor house that was there when he bought it. Farleigh Hungerford was built more for prestige and show rather than for battle, and it's what would be called a fortified manor house. And this fortification part actually got Thomas into some trouble. Back in those days, you had to ask the king permission to fortify a building. And in 1383, Thomas was charged with crenellating without a license. But he was pardoned and allowed to continue building. It's good to know important people. This is the gatehouse, which would have originally been the main entrance. There also would have been a drawbridge here. You can see the Hungerford coat of arms, and just below it is the faint outlines of what would have been a sickle. The sickle was the heraldic badge of the Hungerford family. Our next Hungerford is Thomas's third son, Walter, the first Baron of Hungerford. Thomas and his son Walter built most of the castle as you see it today. And Walter ended up becoming quite an important person in English history. He served under three Lancastrian kings, Henry IV, V, and VI, and he continued to build on the relationship with the Lancasters that was started by his father. Walter was knighted by Henry IV, which, if you remember, Henry IV was John of Gaunt's son, who his father Thomas served, and Walter was a commander in Henry V's army at the infamous Battle of Agincourt, and many other triumphs throughout the Hundred Years' War with the king. He was rewarded for his military service by receiving a knighthood of the Garter, and when Henry V died, Walter was made the guardian of baby King Henry VI, and he also served as treasurer of England. During his lifetime, Walter managed to amass over 100 manors and other estates. Walter pretty much financially set up the Hungerford dynasty for life. And you'll see what ends up happening to all that money and land a bit later. This large area was added by Walter to increase the size and impressiveness of the castle. While doing this, the old parish church of St. Leonard was added to the property, which you can see here. Luck started to change drastically for the Hungerfords at this point. All the wealth that had been amassed during the family's history was starting to be depleted. Robert, the second Baron of Hungerford, had a very short tenure at the castle, and his son, also named Robert, was captured and imprisoned for 7 years and 4 months in France. His mother had to mortgage the Hungerford estates to pay the ransom of £7,966. When Robert returned from imprisonment, he joined the Lancastrian cause of the War of the Roses, and he was executed. His son was also hung, drawn, and quartered. The castle was then seized by the crown and given to Richard, Earl of Gloucester, who at the time was only 16 years old, and he eventually became King Richard III.
Now we come to Sir Edward Hungerford, and Edward attended Henry VIII at the Field of the Cloth of Gold, which was a very, very, very expensive summit between Henry VIII and King Francis I of France. But this isn't the important part. Just after this, Edward married his second wife, Agnes Cottle. And Agnes was a widow whose husband just happened to have been the steward of Sir Edward. Now, how Agnes became a widow is the interesting part. On July 26th, 1518, Agnes enlisted the help of two yeomen from a nearby town named William Ingus and William Matthew. And with the help of these two men, Agnes strangled her husband and murdered him. They then threw the body into the castle kitchen fires and burned it. It wasn't until Edward died that Agnes had proceedings taken against her, and in February of 1524, she was convicted and hung for murder. It was never known if Edward was involved in this plot or if he just protected her while he was alive.
It's said the ghost of Lady Agnes Hungerford is still known to haunt these grounds, usually at twilight, in the vicinity of the chapel.
This tower right behind me became known as the Lady Tower. And how this tower got its name is a story that will curl your toes.
After Agnes was executed, the castle passed to her stepson, Walter. Walter was an attendant and squire to Henry VIII. Walter married two women in quick succession and then finally married his third wife, Elizabeth, in 1532. Elizabeth's father recommended his new son-in-law to Thomas Cromwell, who was becoming increasingly influential in Henry VIII's court. Walter and Thomas's relationship ended up being quite a fruitful one. So much so that Cromwell bestowed upon Walter the title of Lord Hungerford of Heytesbury. Apparently, Walter had quite a large amount of power and influence, and was also extremely abusive. He locked his wife Elizabeth in a tower and starved her, and repeatedly tried to poison her. Elizabeth had a letter smuggled out to Cromwell where she asked to divorce her husband, and in this letter, she may also have alluded to her husband's homosexual behavior. In an excerpt of the letter that still exists, it describes how she had been continually locked in one of my lord's towers of his castle in Hungerford, as I have been these 3 or 4 years past, without comfort of any creature, and under the custody of my lord's chaplain, which has once or twice heretofore poisoned me. I have none other meat nor drink but such as cometh from the said priest. I have drank my own water, or else I should die for lack of sustenance. She further asks to divorce her husband, and writes, I may sooner object such matters against him with many other detestable and urgent causes that he can against me, if I would express them as he well knoweth. This is the portion that possibly alludes to homosexuality. When Thomas Cromwell fell out of favor, so too did Walter Hungerford. Thomas Cromwell was arrested, and at the same time, the Privy Council began to investigate the rumor of Walter's abuse towards his wife. Walter was ultimately convicted of treason, witchcraft, and sexual activity with a man. Hungerford was beheaded on the same day as Thomas Cromwell on Tower Hill on July 28, 1540. Their heads were mounted on spikes and displayed on London Bridge. Hungerford was the first man executed under the Buggery Act and the only man executed of it in the Tudor period. With his head went the title and ownership of Farleigh Hungerford Castle.
Our very last Hungerford for this episode is Sir Edward Hungerford, who is also known as Sir Edward the Spendthrift. And you don't get that nickname for no good reason. Sir Edward was a politician who sat for the House of Commons, and he was also made a Knight of the Bath at the coronation of King Charles II. And King Charles was actually even entertained at Farleigh Hungerford Castle. But what Sir Edward was really known for was his extravagant spending and his gambling. Sir Edward spent 500 guineas, and a guinea is slightly more than a pound, on just one wig. And this is in the late 1600s, so I'll let you do the inflation rates on that, because 500 pounds for a wig now is a lot, so imagine what it would have been back then. And he also gambled away one of the manor houses in the Hungerford estate on a single throw of a bowling match. He was so far in debt that he ended up having to sell off 30 of the Hungerford estates. And 1686, he had to sell Farleigh Hungerford Castle, and he sold it for 56,000 pounds. And that ended the 300-year ownership of the Hungerford family at Farleigh Hungerford Castle. Thank you so much for joining us for our episode at Farleigh Hungerford Castle. I hope you've had fun and enjoyed some of the crazy stories of the Hungerford family and their 300 years at this castle. If you like this episode, give us a thumbs up and a subscribe. And if you want to see some more photography and what inspired me doing this YouTube series, go ahead and go to @EvelynEdwards1. I'll put that down here for you. And we'll see you next time. I'm Evelyn Edwards, and this